quick announcements.
Jerry.
If we can get started here.
There's two more.
You're about 3 minutes early. Am I? Not according to that one.
According to mine.
It's good to be back.
Lucky you never left.
So, we'll make a couple of announcements. So, first of all, I want to just set this in context, okay? This class, the schedule which is in front of you, is not some great master plan idea of Christian education that I've come up with, okay? This was actually born out of our ministry fair last year, and the table that I sat next to was Dee Hoff's table, the library table, and we got to talking, and she was bragging on her husband, and she was talking about how he had all the works of Dietrich Bonhoeffer. And I said, really? You know, because at first blush, I would not have pictured Art being kind of a Dietrich Bonhoeffer expert. Oh yeah, she said. And I said, okay, well, that would be beneficial for the group to have some of that expertise spill over into the bigger body. And then, lo and behold, Ken Miller isn't going to say this, but we got into a conversation one day about C.S. Lewis, and Ben Miller asked me if I had read the biography of C.S. Lewis, and he bought me the book. And I said, well, Ken must have a little expertise in C.S. Lewis. And so, okay, now there's two authors, two people that we have a little bit of expertise in. So, you know, maybe this could grow. And lo and behold, it did grow. And so we ended up with, you know, with seven authors. And the schedule you see before you has no rhyme or reason other than I asked the presenters when they could present. So don't think that this is chronological. Don't think it's got any intellect to it. It's only convenience, okay? So with that, let me just say the first two classes are going to be given by Ken Miller, and so I'm going to let him take it away. We're going to finish right at 9:45. Okay, because church starts at 10, and we want to get the room rearranged and go greet people and get our hearts prepared for worship. Ken.
Oh, prayer.
Well, you can lead the prayer.
Okay. Well, yeah, this is fun, huh? We've got a nice fall day. There's football. People are buying new shoes and clothes, pencils, and cases are all not used up going to school. It's really kind of fun this time of year. Put your mind in a mode where you want to kind of have a perspective, excitement of looking ahead, a little bit of nostalgia looking behind. That's what C.S. Lewis did. So as we go up on this journey, like Joe was saying, we're really not trying to teach a course as much as we're trying to create an interest. Remember those times when you go to the library as a little kid, you have a blanket, you have someone read to you. C.S. Lewis is kind of like that. He reads to you as he writes these things. Because he's not analyzing and teaching, he's sharing the story. So to that end, I want to open with prayer, and then just have the excitement of us to be able to just kind of review where C.S. Lewis came from originally, because you can't understand what he writes unless you know who he was. I mean, can you understand Paul, what he wrote, without really understanding who he was? All the instruments that God uses, they have history. And so, to that end, we want to create an interest by, first of all, looking at where he came from, the writings that you know, and maybe some of them that you're not as familiar with. And he has a huge appeal to secularists and to Christians. And with that, we'll open with prayer and hope with humility. This just kind of leads us to an exciting place where we can share and we can pursue. So, Heavenly Father, we do come before you. We just acknowledge the wonder that is you. Like C.S. Lewis would say, the surprise of joy, the joy the thing within us that always beckons us to look to you. And so to that end, dear Lord, we ask you to be with this group. Let us just share our experiences at the end of the lectures. Let us be open-minded. Let the Holy Spirit work within us to instill in us not only obedience to you, but a love of you for the love that you've shown us through the sacrifice of your Son, your most precious Son, Jesus Christ. So, you know, this is one of the few times that maybe I can talk 45 minutes and people can't run away. My wife lasts about 5 minutes. But, you know, Christianity is called a personal relationship with Jesus, a personal relationship with God. And that personal relationship of all historical people that are these pillars of Christianity sometimes has been one of solitude. Solitude not from the perspective of they didn't enjoy it, but solitude from the perspective of it was very personal. And then in sharing this personal solitude, we find the body of Christ, which is each of us has a story. And so, to that end, I'm going to hand out something. And the whole idea of this little handout, basically, is a two-pager. The first page has 10 bullets. You can make some notes if you like. You can talk later. The second page is what we're going to cover next week, which is going to actually be the writings of C.S. Lewis, although we'll cover those today too. But anyway, I was talking to Joe one time, you know, how do you convince somebody to turn to the Lord, you know? We know that they will turn to the Lord because of need, but how do you actually convince the reason to get someone to turn to the Lord? And that's really the thing that C.S. Lewis experience, and that's what we're going to go quickly today. And when you look at this journey that C.S. Lewis took, you look first at your own journey, and then you look at the journey of the pillars that are within Christianity that you kind of serve. So I'll tell you a little bit of my journey. You know, when Dan or when Frank kind of shares how they found the Lord, where they grew up in, you find a wonderful victory, slam the ball on the ground type of story of each one of us. Because it's not a story that we constructed through our will, it's a story of how the Lord is working our lives in the Holy Spirit. Very fundamental from the standpoint of all glory and grace those who are the Lord's planning God. So my story very quickly basically was a couple of bullets as I was raised in the community. That I just went back to. Very heavy on Mennonites, Amish, and I had a great grandfather that was Amish, and this little community, everybody grew up as a Christian. That doesn't mean that everybody was saved, but everybody grew up with ideals and standards, like the Corlisses, where people had Christian ideals of their life. I think it was the best of times for the world. I was born in 44. You know, I still had French fries that were made with the bad stuff, and I could still smell coffee the way it was supposed to be, and the music was kind of a transition from Japan to whatever. It was values that we, in a way, have kind of lost. We had no TV, we had a radio laid on the floor, and we listened to a big beer and all that stuff like that. And I went to church every single Sunday, not because I chose to, but because that's what it was. C.S. Lewis was placed in Ireland, and we're going to go into this. And the placement of the Lord is for his glory, you know. Westminster Confession is the purpose of life, it's glorified by God and enjoying forever. These are basic things that we grew up with, where we had a purpose, and that purpose was just understood. It wasn't discussed. It was just lived out, and it wasn't something that was immediately wonderful from the standpoint of our compliance to Christian values. It's just where we were. So in the Lutheran religion, you get baptized, so I'm saved, I'm good to go. And then you go through confirmation, now I understand what's going on, I'm even better to go, and I'm taking the body and the blood, which is only given to people that are confirmed in the Lutheran religion. And it's not exclusive of anybody else, everybody in my little town went to church. And so that was just kind of a happy days type thing that I grew up with, but I didn't feel real secure, went off to college, eventually found the land, which was problems of God. And I, at a point in Germany, going to an American Richmond thing, Joanne and I were at Germany at the Walker Hotel, had breakfast with a minister friend of ours who was teaching one of the courses, and I said, how do I really know I'm saved? So that's my journey. I did all this stuff, but how do I know? How do I know this? And what do I really know? Okay? Now, from there, I went to a situation where 5 years ago, my mother died. And then you start looking at the reality of what life really is about. And I remember the minister that was with my mom said, Ruby, you're going through something, you're saying, I want to die. She saw Jesus at the bed. I didn't know it was going to happen. And you're asking, well, why can't I just die? She lingered for 3 days, and he says, you know, there's a purpose for everybody when they live their life. To share that means that experience with other people that the loving God does to bring him close to us. So then I start talking to Joe, and he goes, when did you get so excited about reading this and reading that and all the rest of it? And I says, well, it's just that I'm running out of time. And my cat was under me, so anybody talked to me. And I started reading all of this stuff, starting with philosophy and all this kind of stuff. And all of a sudden, I was on a journey where I was trying to accumulate the basis of the big philosophical question, which is, what is the purpose of life? And how do we live a good life? Now, that's what Socrates and Plato mean. Which again, C.S. Lewis is going to refer back to as mysticism. Now mysticism, when you think about mysticism, is basically those stories that are told culturally that have commonality between all generations and all countries and nations throughout time. And there's mysticism, which he calls true mysticism, and there's mysticism, which we call a shadowing, foreshadowing. Now how many people have heard of Shadowlands, the story of C.S. Lewis, has to do with the wounded of love and all the rest of it. And it has to do with a critical thing that C.S. Lewis had, which was called joy. And he perceived that this perception of joy was really our yearning for the home that we really belong to. Because foreknowledge is truly the word know, and the word know is not reason. The term know is love. Because as I say in the Bible, that Adam knew Eve. So this knowing, this knowledge, this in the moment type thing that is going on, which is called joy, is really very critical to C.S. Lewis. Now this seems like kind of a big setup here, but I'm really trying to say basically, if you were going to boil C.S. Lewis down to anything, you would have to say, it is a term joy. Now, joy is not a term which means happy, and joy is not a term that means pleasure. Joy is transcendent. It is a shadowing. It is a look into the present God, who is using this as a signpost that points you towards Him. How we get there, I have no problems if you're Armenian and you say, I make the choice, or person that says, like a Calvinist, oh, God was the one. The point is, it doesn't happen without God. And it's that love of God that brings us to Him. C.S. Lewis says this thing. He says, you know, if you have Shakespeare and he's writing a play and he's going to meet Hamlet and the two of them are going to meet each other, he says, it sounds nothing like this, he says, it would have to be the initiative of Shakespeare to make it happen. Creation, the character cannot make it happen. It has to be Shakespeare. It has to be Shakespeare, the creator, that makes the relationship happen. So, who else has had this kind of thing? My gosh, just go ahead and read through all the literature. Augustine had his moment. Martin Luther had his moment. These were moments where people who were better Christians than we would ever want to be had aha moments. John Wesley had his moment. After he was defeated going to Savannah and trying to be a person as an evangelist to the Americans and the natives who were in Savannah, and he got choked by a girl that didn't marry the right one, he came back at all the money. He had his moment. John Newton had his moment where he found the Lord. But truthfully, the Lord had already found him before he realized what this finding thing is really about. And that's C.S. Lewis's journey. That's why he can write something and appeal to a layperson, because he truly lived what he is writing. And he's not a scientist putting together logically like reason. He is a person that is sharing his life story. Kierkegaard had his moment where he came up with the term angst. You heard that Jewish term angst that came from Kierkegaard, which was a realization that you can take care of yourself and maybe you can kind of be altruistic and help other people, but you really get to the point where there's a goal where you have to leave and you have to let go. You have to submit. Pride is the thing that kills everybody. Pride is doing it yourself. The wonderful love is the meek will inherit the earth. Blessed are the people that are suffering, because that gives us the loving reality of what brings to us, for us to understand that He truly is our Father, and that He knew us, loved us, before we found Him. It's like stories you hear all the time about a little kid going across the road, and you go across the road, and your father is holding the hand of the little kid and instructing, this is what you need to do. The whole time you're crossing that road, He never lets go of the hand. And the little kid is on the other side, what's he saying? Look what I did. I mean, think about all those things. So, that basically is kind of the setup, introduction for what we're going to talk about here. And what we're going to talk about basically is a journey that someone took, if you will, a tool of the Lord. His journey where the Lord took him and applied what he went through to other people to influence millions. And it was a journey that was fraught with frustration, anxiety, pain, joy. It was a real life, non-Hollywood kind of journey. And it was something that was orchestrated by the providence of God. All the way through, God did it. So we start out with C.S. Lewis. And if you look at the outline there, you'll see the first thing we're going to talk about basically is who he was. And we're actually going to get into a little bit more formal introduction. And the introduction to C.S. Lewis is he was born in 1898. He lived 1 week short of 65 years. He died on the 22nd of November 1963. What do we remember about that day?
Kennedy's death.
Absolutely. Got completely wiped out. Who else died on that day? Aldous Huxley, Brave New World, died on the same exact day. And he wrote Dystopia, which was basically this concept that humanism couldn't create an ideal thing like you would have with Thomas More or you would have with H.G. Wells. Now think about when all these people are living. I mean, it's amazing the people who live at the same time. I never realized that. You know, Martin Luther, he lived at the same time as Pope Leo, the guy that was actually a de' Medici. He was actually during the Renaissance period. So it ended up the guy who was actually de' Medici in Florence, who then, because of his money, became the Pope of the Catholic Church, excommunicated Martin Luther, who put his 95 theses on. I mean, it's amazing how all this works. It does not work simply by itself or through human construct. It's amazing how all these things swirl together. And it's also amazing that when you look at what people do, Barack Obama said something that was very true. Remember one of the things he said was, you didn't build that. Well, I was offended by that originally, by thinking, well, of course I did that. But the truth is, he says, well, you know, your business depended upon a bridge that somebody else did. see as books, when you look at all these wonderful things that he did, and this is the fun thing about getting into books and reading literature and stuff, you realize that there were people before him, there are people that he worshipped. G.K. Chesterton, a generation before him, wrote those same words about mere Christianity, that Jesus claims to be the Son of God. He is, that's Chesterton. There's another guy named George MacDonald, and he wrote fantasy type articles, and it's amazing the articles that he wrote, the books that he wrote for children, were the same books that C.S. Lewis's wife was reading to be, Joy Davidman. She was reading the same books before the two of them ever met each other, and these kind of imaginative type things that C.S. Lewis was doing, these were things that were used later by God for him to be able to bring the word of God to secularists, atheists. Now, how was that done? What is C.S. Lewis most known for worldwide? Narnia. Chronicles of Narnia, where he actually didn't make an allegory. He said, I'm going to make a story. What if Jesus was a lion in a world of animals that could talk? Wouldn't it play out this way? Narnia is a wonderful story. 7 books. When you get in there and read all of these books and stuff, all of a sudden, just like his own personal period when he went from Christianity to atheism and back to Christianity, the Lord sneaks in and all of a sudden he's got you. And that's exactly what he said. The hounds of heaven are pursuing me. The most dejected of people, I finally submitted and knelt and I accepted God. Did he say he accepted Jesus? 2 years later. But you know, God is a person who creates everything and he creates all the forces of nature. And he's subject to none. So we get kind of hung up many times in churches where we say to ourselves, I don't like the way they do it, I think we do it better and all the rest of it. But the truth of the matter is, God is a person, now this may sound silly, who is very simple. What I mean simple is he's complete in everything that he does. It's already perfect. It's not past, it's not future, it's always present, but it's present in our future, present in their past. So God has this overview of everything that brings everything together, and that really is the wonder, the mystery that we don't understand, because we cannot reason the way God basically functions. There are many, many, many books that you can read about Christianity, but if you don't start at the very beginning, which is the attributes of God, you miss them all. You were always trying to say, love, humans are saying this, is kindness. I do this, and I do that, and I do this, and I do that. Love is much more than kindness. A godly love is much more than that. It's complete sacrifice. And when Tim Keller writes his books, The Dance and Everything, he talks about the triune God, and how the triune God basically has a person that projects love and an object, which is God, projects to the Son. And he projects that through the Holy Spirit as the same way it works for us. That's why I'm always saying that a church should always say, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit. Because anything else becomes a formula. It becomes, rather than living it like C.S. Lewis did, it becomes something that is what we can say proudly, we did. But truthfully, it's always being God. We have the blessing after Pentecost of having the Holy Spirit actually within us. So we get together and we look at all of this stuff and everything, and I have a really punching clock. And we start to look at what was C.S. Lewis doing and where did he come from? Well, where he came from basically is very simple. Now, he, like John Newton and so many other people, it's the same story. It's kind of my story in Indiana. He was born a Christian, not born a Christian, well, maybe with Calvin, he was born a Christian, semantically. But he was born in Ulster, which is Northern Ireland, and he was born basically Irish Protestant. Okay? Let's just call them all Anglicans. And he was born to a woman who was this wonderful woman that he loved dearly, and she was actually the daughter of a pastor. Again, did he do that? is the promise of God, the love of God. To use him as a tool to get to us and have this conversation. And so we also have, and she basically was a mathematician, she was an accountant, they lived in Ireland. Ireland is a wonderful place, and they lived kind of in solitude with lots of books around and everything. Everything was green and little elves around the corner and everything. And you can kind of see where all this stuff later comes from, because in Ireland, he also had a father, and the father basically was a solicitor. In England, they have lawyers that are either, I'll do the records, or I'll do the law stuff, barristers and solicitors. And he was kind of an old school type father where she took care of him, and they had a housemaid that took care of them. And but he was off working, and he was very formal and very self-educated. He also was born with a brother that was 2 years older, and he was born with a dog. Now, why do I mention this? Well, one of the names that he went by all the time was Jack. This is where you get all this stuff, and you start really reading who the person is, not just what he wrote. That dog, Jackie, died. And at the age of 7, he says, from now on, I'm only going to be called Jackie, and he shortened it to Jack, and all his friends called him Jack, because the dog is kind of like the Indiana Jones type thing, where Indy is named after the dog. So you see the personality of these people. It's not like they're actually determining everything they do by reason. They are basically a product of what the Lord has put together in their lives. So just like John Newton and C.S. Lewis, both of them, their mothers died when they were like 7 years old. Well, when you're 7 years old or so, you really have already been exposed to the Word and understand the Word. When you talk about Billy Graham, he says, well, I found the Lord when I was 17. But Ruth, my wife, found it when she was 5. And she really did. So I had a discussion once with someone about the prodigal son. And it's called the son. It's not called the prodigal wannabe a Christian or wannabe a child. It's called the prodigal son. I think the prodigal son story is about a person that we're known, that is already known by the Lord, not predetermined, but known in this realm of how God knows. And he's coming back after a journey of falling off the wagon. We Baptists would say backsliding. And he's coming back home again. And the joy is he's coming back home again. But he could never go to the courthouse and not become the son of his father. And I think C.S. Lewis at this stage basically was truly saved. Now to me, salvation has to do with regeneration. Regeneration has to do with the works of the Lord. And the rest of it is obedience, which is that thing, as a Lutheran, I couldn't quite get my head around, which is sanctification, which is trying to understand what to do when you're doing it because not that you want to earn it, but because you love the Lord. And again, even that joy or that motive to get in to want to do it is not of yourself. It is grace. That's where it is. So anyway, he's going along, he's in a family that basically reads a lot of books, they're kind of in an isolated area, it's real pretty, there's lots of mysticism, he plays games with his brother, and he plays games where they have little animals that talk. Now this may not happen like in Texas, but everything is green and you've got all of the Irish lore and the Celtic heritage and everything. Everything basically is revolving around his biggest thing, which is imagination. Now what did Jesus say? Jesus said we have to come to the Lord as a child. What did he really mean by that? Like, you're going to do what I have to do? I don't think so. I think a child comes to the Lord with trust. And what is faith? Faith is not reason, belief. Faith is just trust and belief. And so, it's kind of sad, you know, have you guys ever seen the movie Polar Express? With the little bell? Okay. But what's the big deal about that? You can't hear the little bell and what happens? Your imagination goes. Your trust goes. You become part of the world. Remember the world, the flesh, and the devil. He will later write about all of these things because that was his journey. In the books that he writes about the world, the flesh, and the devil, talks about Screwtape letters like what you're reading, which is great, which is ways that, that if you will, the world, the flesh and the devil are used against you. And so these things will come back again and again because by example, he's taking a journey. So this journey that he takes basically goes a little bit like this. His mother dies. Now, it's interesting because I just want to preface this by saying there are going to be three women in his life, and it is kind of a retread of the same thing that happens three different times. His mother, who really gives him all the affection they love, like mothers do, she dies. Later, there's going to be a woman that's called Moore, and I'll get into that, and she's 27 years his elder when he's in Oxford. He watches over her, and she dies. And then lastly, he says, I did not understand, but here I am in my late 50s. I found the love of my life. It was an intellectual love before it was a romantic love. Joy Davidman, who was a divorcee from America, she dies. So it's this thing about trusting someone to the point that you give your all to this person and they die. And he does, you believe. He rants at the Lord, yells at him. I don't believe again, I don't believe again, I don't believe again. He did that and became an atheist as a child at nine. And he did that later when he was like, what would it be, 63 years old, and wrote something that was absolutely profound out of that. The Lord was using that at the age of 62 when David had died. Now I'm just going to jump to that area. Because the way it kind of goes is some of the things that he's known for, there's like five, six books that everybody knows as a Christian, or are really applicable if you're a Christian. Because he was a Christian apologist, and so on that side, everybody loves him because as a Christian they go, he's the most noted person, he's wonderful. But he had faults, he had warts, so did Luther, so did all those people. Because their story syncs with us, because they were real people sharing what really happened. So the ones that he wrote that pertain basically to this grief is called The Problem of Pain. The Problem of Pain we're going to go into next week. But basically it has to do with the fact that how could a loving God create such a miserable world? If he is all powerful and all love, he either doesn't care or he's not as powerful as he says he is. Ergo, there can't be a God. But then he explains why that isn't true. And he also gets into them when and he says this intellectually, and he's asked by friends, well, what would you do if you had a loss? This is before he met this woman that later dies that he married. He says, I'm a coward, I don't know. And we don't know. We can talk about things like abortion and stuff like that and really set it up reverse. That's what we do as humans. You never know for sure what you're going to do at the time. But I dare say that the Lord will bring you through it and make you stronger because of the suffering. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the world. Okay? And blessed are those who suffer, because theirs is the kingdom of God. And those are things basically to give us humility so that we can walk with the Lord and so that basically we can move on. So he wrote this book, which is we've observed, and he wrote it under a pseudonym. Now this is amazing. Wrote it under a pseudonym. And this is almost comical. And in this, he had four different journals and published his publications. Really very great. The Weight of Glory is another thing that he wrote, which is very great. And he published this basically as he went through these stages of grief. Everybody know Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, five things. And basically, they're the secularist, but really she doesn't mention anything about faith or God. It's really kind of sad. It's kind of a psychology approach, psychiatric approach to things. First of all, you deny, then you get angry, then you go ahead and bargain, I'm going to go ahead and do this, if you do that, then you become depressed. And then she says, then you accept it. Well, the deal is, as a Christian, when you get to those layers, you go through the first four, believe me. No matter what you say, you go through the first four. And he did. He was very mad about it. Lost his religion, if you will, for a little while. That never was really gone. Came out stronger to share this story with people. And what we have as Christians is then we let go. I mean, the secular world always says you've got to come up to the plate, you've got to hit the home run, you've got to be all you can be, just do it, all those kind of things. The Christian says, just submit and fall on your face. And guess what? When you do that, the attributes of God, these books over here, I'll share with you tonight, will come forth and will rescue from what is going on. And then you grow stronger. So the funny thing is, when he wrote this book under a pseudonym, and all his friends knew that he was going through all of these problems and everything, what did his friends do? This is amazing. They gave him the book. They said, hey, I know you're going through this thing. This guy's written some stuff that's really good. Maybe he can help you. So anyway, you got this set up and everything that he had going on in Ireland. And then he was always educated with lots of books. And he was educated with private schools, homeschooling. His mom died. And then he ended up going to very private schools, he and his brother. The English way of doing it is, now you go to England from Ireland to get a real education. We know eventually he ends up in Oxford. So he goes to Ireland at a time, and during this time that he's in Ireland, I mean, goes to England, during this time when he's like 15 or 16 or so, he becomes a materialist. What's that really mean? Like, he's a humanist. He's an atheist. He's a person that follows Shaw. He's a person that follows H.G. Wells. He's a person that believes in evolution. You know, all of these kind of things. He completely dismisses everything to do with God because, and this is very important, because although he kept his imagination, his reason took over, and the person that he had was a guy named, Kirkpatrick, called him Old God. And Kirkpatrick was a person that when he was met by Kirkpatrick getting off the bus, after his father sent him to the mentor that his father had had, C.S. Lewis trying to equip and be kind of like a, hey, it's really a nice day or so. And Kirkpatrick says to him, well, how do you know? Well, I suggest you don't say anything until you actually think about that and you really learn what a nice day entails, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So he became very methodical, logical, a very thinking kind of person. He also was a person who was very much into, like we said before, mysticism, got a little bit into the occult. He was what we call a romantic. A romantic is a person that's not only kissy-kissy, a romantic is a person that is Italian. I need all the emotions, you know, the hate, the love, all of those kind of things. You embrace them all. And he said that the romantics, even though many romantics are not Christians, at least they have an identification with imagination. They're not butcher structures, so that everything is like thinking. They allow things to come in, and those things that can come in, he says, are shadows, shadows of the Lord, saying to you, this is your home. This is where you need to go. So, I'm going to digress here for 1 second and talk about something called joy. Now, he wrote this autobiography before he met David, which is called Surprised by Joy. How many people? Well, did you know that Surprised by Joy comes from Longfellow, Henry Wadsworth Longfellow? See, this is what I mean about if you really get in and you read the biography of Lewis, you get more appreciation. It's like knowing one person and going to their family reunion, and all of a sudden you know 50 people, not just that one people. He got his stuff from Longfellow. Very quickly, Longfellow was a person that wrote a poem called Surprised by Joy. Very touching. And C.S. Lewis, being a romantic, of course, he's been lecturing on that. And so Longfellow had this daughter. He loved her immensely. She was ill. It was protracted. She ended up dying. And he mourned and mourned and mourned and mourned her, that process. And so one day he's walking along. Tell me how many times this hasn't happened to you. All of a sudden there's a glint of sun. There's something that happens. And you kind of have this imagining surreal type joy that all of a sudden comes poking in. And you can identify it and you can remember it, but you can't institute it, you can't make it happen, and you can't repeat it. And he says that that's the signpost that the Lord has transcended. There's something better that we have right here. That is joy. And so he wrote this poem how basically he felt almost guilty because all of a sudden he was happy enough. A good feeling about himself should be feeling bad. And Lewis is surprised by joy. It's his journey, like the prodigal son, to come back to the Lord. I contend that he was once saved, always saved, and the Lord used him as a means through his providence to be able to come to other people through Narnia, and also come to Christians, and also to be able to make sense during World War I and World War II of why stuff happens. So he goes from Kirkpatrick, and he ends up getting a scholarship at 16. He goes to Oxford. Class is very small, only 8. And now get this, he's a materialist, he's a humanist, he's an atheist. He's not an agnostic who simply says, oh, I don't know. He's a person who says, I do know, and my reason tells me there is not a God, but there's something back here with my imagination that tells me, no, there's really something more structured that's beyond what I see right here. So he's a divided person. And he'll have relationships with other people at Oxford, which will actually allow him to bring those two together. Wonderful people. Tolkien. He hung with Tolkien. They wrote each other's books, read things back and forth. Wow, now there's another person that spins off of this. And so anyway, World War II is coming along. He joins the reserves. It's towards the end of the war. He ends up leaving college. He wanted to go to college at Oxford. And when he's in his base camp, before he goes to the trenches over in France, he meets a guy named Paddy Moore. He and Paddy Moore are good chums, and they both agree that if either of them dies, they will take care of each other's families, their own family and the other guys too. So when he's in the trenches, towards the end of the war, there's a round that goes by the British that falls short, lands there, kills his friends around him, wounds him severely, he becomes depressed, he goes back to England, he's in convalescence. And then later, in the trenches in France, Paddy Moore dies. So he keeps his promise to Paddy Moore, because Paddy Moore's mother lives near Oxford. And Mrs. Moore, his second love, if you will, I don't necessarily mean romantically, but second love, the one that he ended up calling his mother to other people, he takes care of her. In fact, later, her daughter, Maureen, and Paddy Moore, and his brother, Warren, and himself by this house, the kiln, and it's near Oxford, and they live in this house kind of communally all together, although C.S. Lewis also keeps a dorm room, if you will, at his study, which is at Oxford. And it's interesting that when C.S. Lewis dies, he actually dies in that house. He'll die later because of heart disease and nephritis and stuff like that. So when he goes back, the other thing, see, here's the loving thing. The mother, Patty Moore, she ends up visiting him and convalescing him in the hospital, brings him through, and then later he takes care of her when she's ill, that is with her when she dies. And there's just this real realization of how people just help each other. So then you end up going basically to Oxford. He teaches as a professor at Oxford. Later he gets a chair at Cambridge, so I guess he's got sweaters. And when he's at Oxford, he ends up basically being an English lit, remember in college, an English lit teacher. But he's more than that. He's kind of a historian. He studies very much about philosophy. And he gets into, because of the romance, chivalry and the romantic literature, anything that basically has to do with kind of that golden age when Christianity was still accepted as the norm. We're talking the 1700s, the 1800s, before we were told to think what we want to think, how we should think through deconstruction, postmodernism, rather than the way people just everybody thought, kind of like my little town. Not that it was better than any place else, it's just they were more choices. Everybody went to church. I wanted to have the car on Saturday. My mom would say, you have the car on Sunday. Okay. So anyway, when all of this is going on and everything, he meets Tolkien. And he and Tolkien become real buds. There's also a guy named Barfield, who is a poet. And there also is a guy named Dyson. And Dyson is also another literary. These are all professors hanging together. They have a club, which I'd love to have a club like this, called the Inklings. Everybody heard of the Inklings? Mm-hmm. How cool. They would meet at a little bar. That's not bad. They smoke cigars and drink beer, and they would talk. And they would just talk about all sorts of stuff. And they all basically were agnostics at best, some of them atheists, and all of them came to the Lord. In fact, he says they're dropping like flies around me. It's like the Lord is like working within the group, and everybody is a means to somebody else, and they keep discussing things. There's a friend, Jim Edgren has a friend that's out by Duckabush, the Vanderbilts. He's a guy that's from Europe, I want to say Scandinavia or whatever. And he wanted to write this flaming book about how Christianity isn't real. And as he investigated it from a scientific perspective, as he investigated it, he ended up becoming a burden and wrote a book on why Christianity is real. So when you honestly really use your reason and you use your imagination and you don't try to push the Lord off to the side, and you simply surrender as you cry out of the way, the Lord comes in you, and like a little kid going across the street, you may say later, I picked up this book and I did it, but the Lord has your hand all the way along the way. Because his love is much, much, much stronger than what our love is. Our love is kindness. His love is really true love. So, he's doing all of these things, and while they're in Oxford, they start writing some books. Now, the kind of books that he ends up writing, some of them will come out later during World War II, but the kind of books that he starts writing are books that are kind of philosophical books, and the books that he kind of writes are books that can appeal to the public at large, and also to Christians later in specifically. Now, I already mentioned Narnia. He also wrote one, which was a space travel type trilogy. And Tolkien started and was going to write one which was going to be a time travel. Now, who are his peers? H.G. Wells. You see, all this stuff is going on at the same time. Nothing happens in a vacuum. It's kind of like music playing constantly. You've got some people over here that love nature, like on Walden Pond, because they're worshiping the creation, and you have other people that are looking at the same stuff and coming back and saying, I can see general revelation through nature that shows that there's a God, not a communal pantheistic kind of thing. So then World War II comes along. World War II comes along, and he's asked now, because he is a soldier, that's another one thing that he was, he's asked by the government to actually basically talk about the war and patriotism and stuff like that. And he doesn't want to be political. He says, I will not do that, but I'll do a BBC talk type thing. And he does a series of things on the radio, and he does a series of articles in some Christian magazines. And these later are put into books. And what he's doing basically is just being a layperson. He says, I'm not a minister, I'm a layperson, but I'm telling you my Christian outreach. He answers why they should be patriotic, why they should care, what the purpose of pain is as far as enduring, why is there suffering, why is there this, why is there that. And he starts reading G.K. Chesterton, hard reading, really hard to read. You think Schaefer's art? Chesterton's very hard. He gives 200 pages to say something that can be said at 10.
Yeah.
But it is wonderful stuff to read, yeah. Old school type stuff. He wrote the book that became a pillar. This is one of the things that moved C.S. Lewis along, called The Everlasting Man. We know the Everlasting God. I saw on the program we're talking about the Everlasting God. I saw there. Everlasting Man is Jesus. And then he also read stuff by MacDonald. And MacDonald basically talked about how he could create a story, if you will, an Alice in Wonderland story, but from a Christian perspective, not just from a secular perspective. And if you will, get Christian values and things that go in. Out of these end up coming near Christianity. We're going to go into that more thoroughly, which is basically, what is the commonality of all Christians? Why should you be a Christian? And secondly, after you're a Christian, how should you behave? And then the third thing, near Christianity, it's four parts, but the broadcast for three. The third thing is, what is the purpose of God, reading into the books and stuff like that. Now, one of the things about C.S. Lewis, which is really so good about New Christianity, is he did not want to get into the religion part. He wanted to get into the you're saved part, trying to be Lord. He says everybody has thirst, they need water. Everybody needs food. let's not sit and talk about the vitamins and which ones are the ones that really do this and do that. Let's just talk about the food and the water. So from that perspective, in Mere Christianity, he talks about accept the Lord. Once you accept the Lord in a great hall, there are many rooms. Go into the room that you want and worship the Lord. And there's a Catholic room, there's a Methodist room, there's a Reform room. Truly, the Lord uses us not to have us build ourselves up, but simply to affect other people. That's what C.S. Lewis does. So all of this is going on and everything, and let me see where I'm at. Oh, and I've already said that. And so anyway, he, during this time and shortly before that, he ended up having a walk, a very famous walk. He ended up having a very famous walk with Dyson and Tolkien. And even those two people had their falling outs once in a while. Tolkien, who was Catholic, wanted him to become Catholic. He ended up becoming Anglican. And once he became Anglican and found the Lord after talking to these guys, he's got a little deal where he says he knelt after a conversation with them one day, didn't plan it, and accepted the Lord, the most dejected of sinners, the most non-prodigal of all prodigal reconstituted people. He says, I just gave up and gave him to the Lord. Once he accepted the Lord, then he started going to church. Now, R.C. Sproul writes something that's really very interesting. R.C. Sproul talks about how he was raised in a church that basically was a minimalized church, didn't really believe in the resurrection, didn't really believe in the incarnate, but kind of like was more of a social justice type church. And he said the interesting thing was when he was in college, he went to get a pack of cigarettes, and then all of a sudden, basically, he met somebody that was there, and he accepted the Lord. And he attributes that to not the encounter on the stairs, but the fact that he was in the church, and he was receiving the gospel, which was being read, even though it was being perverted by the minister, the gospel still speaks for itself. And so, C.S. Lewis, after he became a theist, ended up going to church. He said, you should wave your flag if you're going to be a Christian. So he ended up going to Trinity Church, which was in Oxford, and he heard scripture. He didn't like church, didn't like the organ, thought that it was too noisy. Didn't like the people that heard the sermons because they were kind of boring. He was kind of like 9 years ahead of them. But he received the word. Remember that deal about general revelation we've been studying? Special revelation. General revelation is there's a God out there. Special revelation, you're only saved through scripture. And that is the reason why even if you have a hyper-Calvinist, you spread the gospel and give the good word. Because it's not intentions, it's the gospel that saved you. And what is the gospel? The Holy Spirit inspired in the church. That's the grace. That's the true love of God. So anyway, later on a bus ride, 2 years later, in 1931, after 1929, finding God, he ended up going to, it's so difficult. He's on a bus ride, and he can't remember exactly when, but when he started the bus to go to the zoo, he wasn't, didn't believe in Christ, and when he got there, he believed in Christ. And that's really kind of the way it happens. We try to figure out when things happen, but they happen on God's schedule. That happened with Spurgeon. He ended up in a snowstorm going into the school, into a church that was a Baptist church. And, you know, everybody has said, you know, St. Augustine, Luke had seen a jingle jingle that was basically out of Romans. Martin Luther out of Romans. That's when it happened. So he ends up becoming a Christian, and then after all of that, he ends up transferring over to Cambridge. The important thing about Cambridge is he became the president of the Socratic Club, which was basically a club where he would field any atheist questions against Christianity. And remember William F. Buckley? He used to have those talks on TV. And they were very civil. He would have civil conversations with people that didn't believe in the Lord. And he, like Paul, could actually give his testimony because the Holy Spirit convicted him, but he knew all the other stuff. He knew both sides of it. Now, I'm just going to quickly go to David Benn. He married this gal named David Benn. Even that was a gracious thing that he did. she was a person that was basically originally Jewish. She came from like Poland. She was like in fucking Colombia. She went to New York. She married another guy. She was an author. She was a prodigy. There was one deal where she read some fancy music classical thing just once and then played it from memory. And she was an author. She was a poet. And she and her husband, basically, after they got married, started searching for something more, if you will, than just their humanism. She came to the Lord. Now get this. She came to the Lord through C.S. Lewis's writings. He'd never met her. And then later she comes to England and she meets him. And lo and behold, what happens? She gets divorced. She comes to the UK. The United States, UK gives her a visa. She stays temporarily. He loves her from the standpoint of her intellect. They have talks. She's a little bit spunky. Everything is really neat because he just enjoys being around her. And then all of a sudden she loses her visa. She's going to be sent back to New York. And she ends up marrying. He ends up marrying her with a civil wedding. And if you're in Europe, we all know that in Europe, you have a civil wedding, which is the real one, Christian wedding. That's optional. And so he marries her so that she can stay in England. And they live separately, but they still have this kind of platonic kind of thing going on and everything. And then she ends up getting cancer. She had breast cancer. She didn't know. She went in. She fell to her labor. They found out a site that was originally in her breast. They went to her bone. She was terminal. And so she goes in for therapy. And then at the bedside, these stories are just amazing. At the bedside, he marries her. But the reason why he didn't marry her before was he was Anglican. And back in that day, you cannot marry a divorcee. Remember that old deal? So, anyway, he had a friend who was a priest, and he ended up marrying her. And then they basically lived together for a short period of time, took some trips together. And if you watch a movie series, or two movie series, one's the BBC, that's much better than the one that's done by the Americans, which can make it kind of stupid. It's like Unbroken, when it's done by Angela Jolie, leaves out the whole Christian thing at the end, which is why you read the book, you know. So it's the way Hollywood does it. Watch the British one. And so, anyway, Shadowland again basically had to do with the enjoyment that he had, that they found each other, and that it was the God's doing. Now, she ends up dying, and when she ends up dying, he goes into this terrible, terrible depression. And then 3 years later, he ends up dying. And when he ends up dying, he basically then ends up being buried in Oxford. And so to stay online, I'm going to read you, which is at the burial site, which was written. And I think this is great. So at his burial site, this will finish it up, his burial site is written, "I believe in Christianity as I believe that the sun has risen, not only because I see it, but because by it I see everything." So, now what we're going to do next week is basically, you'll see on the other side, we're going to go over the books, just kind of like a real hypnosis kind of thing with the books. And we're going to try to relate these books to his writings, to where he came from, and the journey that he took. And up here, there's some books that if you really want to try to make sense of all this, it really makes sense. This is a great biography. This is really good. This is the one that Joe was talking about. You can get all of his great books in this one. But I ask you please to go ahead and do The Way of Glory, because this is separate. This is really great. If you want to know what he was going through, Packer, who's an Anglican still alive up in Vancouver, and he writes Knowing God, which is fabulous. And then The Holiness of God by Sproul, excellent. And you got videos on that, right? Yeah, that's good. This is good also by Packer, Fundamentalism, not from the standpoint of crazy type people, but from the standpoint of really inerrancy of the Bible, infallibility of God. Because if you know the character of God, then you can understand how what we are trying to do has to be looked at through his standards, not ours. Remember, we think we're doing love, we're doing kindness. He does, he's the one that can do really love. And another one that's really interesting is Kierkegaard. This little book right here is really fabulous. And then these kind of like track Christianity. This is like the 1800s. Kierkegaard came up, it's very interesting. When I was talking to Jim Edward about Kierkegaard, everybody loves Kierkegaard. They realize Kierkegaard was basically saying, I can't reason God, so I'm just going to have a leap of faith. Fake it till you make it, and then I'll get there. But the interesting thing about that truly is, if you submit to the Holy Spirit will do that leap for you. You can't sign something and say something and get there. It may be a process on the way. It's got to be done by the Holy Spirit. Out of this came Camus and Jean-Paul Sartre, existentialism, where they took it a different way. That's where you get to be on your feet. Skepticism kind of goes over all of it. So, this is really interesting too. This is by Tolstoy. This is a really interesting book. Tolstoy, who had a commune, basically we know War and Peace and Anna Karenina. The main gist of all of that was, he said, I know war is bad. Is it bad because they make us do something or we accept to do something? Kind of like I was only following orders. Well, the funny thing here is he was mad at the Orthodox Church, never believed in the Holy Spirit. And so he ended up basically saying, this ends up being Oprah, if you will, spirituality. The kingdom of God is within you. When Jesus said that, he meant that I am the kingdom, I'm standing in the room. He didn't mean that the kingdom of God is in you by your own volition, by your own will. And so here he's basically saying the kingdom of God is within you. In other words, you can be social justice, you can do it all. You know who took this book and did the great things? Gandhi. Gandhi patterned his whole lifestyle after this book. I mean, all these things are interrelated. I mean, it's really pretty amazing. So, I didn't leave any time for talk, questions. If anybody wants to talk or anything, I'll be around after church. If you want to see these books, if you want to talk to Joe, and then tomorrow, next week, what we'll do basically is just carry this on and try to just approach chronologically. This is a real sentence of chronology. I mean, that's another reason why you want to do chronology, because he writes things as he progresses through his life. We'll see how he made the impact that he did and why.
You want to close this in prayer real quick, Ken?
Me?
Yeah.
Heavenly Father, again, we just humbly come before you, calling our faces, for what else can we do? Just acknowledging the greatness, the glory that is you. And to that end, dear Lord God, we ask you to be ever present in our heart through your Holy Spirit. Cleanse us each day. Let us converse with you each day through prayer. Shape us, use us, ever let us worship you. Thank you for your son, for your sacrifice, and for your love which you showed to all of us. And be with us in this son who's coming. Amen.
Could we have a microphone next year or something, because of all the confusion hearing over here? You can't always pick up. I could.
Yeah, Ken. Kenny, next week, if you could use the microphone, that would help.
You were not alone.
Oh, yeah, there's a microphone there.
Yeah. Well, there was so much commotion going on.
Yeah, good point.